Hello there, my name is Henrique and I'm from Pigdev's channel. I make some game development tutorial in Brazilian Portuguese. If you want to take a look, the link to my channel is in the description. Please do check it out. In this video, we will talk about the design process of an infinite runner that me and Nathan developed. First of all, let's talk about what makes a game an infinite runner. Think about an endless game in which the major objective is just to score points based on dodging obstacles. Just add a scrolling background to it, and voila, you have an infinite runner. That's all that makes an infinite runner, and that's actually a trouble. Think about it for a second. What would you add to make the game more enjoyable? The mechanics constraints are too tight. We could make the character run, jump, and maybe sprint. Not really funny. At first, we thought about platform mechanics, like a jump and basic character movement. It was supposed to be simple, so yeah, a platformer was simple enough. But we immediately thought, we need to add more action to it. We needed something that would raise the player reactions per minute. Then we thought, let's keep it simple. Let's add a slide mechanic to help players avoid the obstacles, the jump of course, and let's try to make the players avoid some gaps on the ground. It was at that moment that we thought about something that would completely change the game and would add the action that we needed. Rookie gun. But since the task of implementing the stuff inside Godot was my responsibility, we chose to make the game in such a way that until we didn't enact the rook shot, it could be played just like any finish run. Due to time constraints, the game couldn't have a big scope, so we would have to make the basics first, and then, if time allowed us, we could add some other stuff. To make this kind of development approach, we tried to make everything as modular as possible, in such a way that we could remove anything from the game and everything else would still work. To do so, we went for this setup. Both spawners are inherited from a basic spawner scene. This is an awesome feature that Godot offers. You can create a basic object and start to build more complex ones. It's kind of an object-oriented design. Also, they ask for a packet scene that will be used as reference to instantiate objects in runtime, so we could make each one spawn different objects. Packet scene is the class that handles saved scenes of your project. This way, we can use it to load scenes at runtime, in this case, the obstacles the player will have to avoid. About the player object now, there's something really important that I have to say. I started by making it a rigid body, which is a class that uses Godot built-in physics engine to apply forces to an object and make it react to forces as well. So that's what happened. I went for it because I thought that by having all physics working without any code, it would be easier to make the behavior we wanted the character had. It was a lazy approach and we lost time with it. The character was very buggy and with some weird movement. I should have listened to Nathan when he told me to code a kinematic body, which is a class that interacts with the physics engine but doesn't use any breathing forces. By coding it from the ground, it would allow us to have much more control over the player behavior. Anyway, we ended up using it. To be able to better fit our design approach, we used a simple state machine to handle the character's states. Only use finite state machines if you have the need to do so. In this case, we find out that it would be good to have one since the character could only be in one state at a time. And we also had very few states, which were running, jumping, hooking and sliding. Even though the hook wasn't implemented yet, but as I said, it could be implemented. About the lost conditions, I secretly implemented one. Since the objects would be moving toward the player, I thought that it would be cool if the character dies when hitting an obstacle from a horizontal collision. Like if the obstacle and the character crashed. And also, I removed the gap condition because it wouldn't make sense to have a slide mechanic if anytime the player could slide to death. And after the first implementation, we ended up with something like this. Yeah, nothing compelling yet. To be honest, this is the worst design scenario you can ever imagine. The game isn't funny yet, and we would have to add features. That's dangerous. In most cases, you would want to go for a subtractive design, where you remove features until the ones you have are very good and compelling. But what would we remove from it? So I asked Nathan to give me a chance to go for an additive approach by allowing the implementation of the hookshot. He agreed and I started to design it. As I said, I had never done this mechanic before, so I researched for references. And I remember Spider-Man and Venom Separation Anxiety for Super Nintendo and the Ninja Rope from Worms series. To be honest, I should have looked for more references. To implement it, I stick with the modular design. I made another scene, the hook gun scene, and created some references for the player character. Where the hook should stay when idle, which object it should follow, the play node, and stuff. This way, the interactions between the objects would be easier to be made. After the implementation of the hook mechanic, this is how the game looked like. Now the game has a new mechanic, it has potential to be more action-based and dynamic, but as before, the player didn't have any incentive to use anything but a boring slide. We realized that when I asked Nathan to evaluate the hookshot implementation. He didn't say that, but I know that he screamed a loud and clear boring off the screen. Yeah, we needed to fix it. Nathan suggested that we could make the player use the jump if we had stick with the plan and make the gaps on the ground, so that the player would need to avoid them by jumping on the spawned objects. I didn't say that to Nathan, but I prefer to give positive feedback to players so that they pursue what the game offers by themselves, so they can receive more positive reinforcement for using what we wanted they to use. Instead of punishing the player for not jump a gap, I asked Nathan if I could add a collectible-ish mechanic, making every obstacle have an item attached to it that would increase the player's score. Since Nathan believed in the game potential and gave me a green light to tweak with the game, I opted to add more stuff. Please do not follow my bad example. After we implemented the whole thing and fixed some other stuff Nathan wisely pointed, like the feel that the hook was sliding on the ceiling instead of attaching itself to it, this was the final implementation we had before Nathan made his dark magic. Now it was looking more like a playable thing. The player now had to efficiently move to increase the score and then compete with his or her friends. The player would have to use everything we offered to him. I'm very happy that I could collaborate with Nathan in this project. I really hope that we could do this again sometime. That's all for now, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. Please hit the like button and keep developing.